They often say the most compelling investment thesis out there always involves some horrible catastrophic event nobody saw coming, except you. And now you're rich and everyone else is poor. Everyone wants to be a Michael Burry, so he famously shorted the 2007 mortgage bond market, making $100 million for himself and $700 million for his investors. For whatever reason, when others suffer, it just makes the gains so much better. Why is that? Well, it's because we all have a bit of sadistic tendencies within us. I think the Stanford prison guard experiment showed us how everyone is capable of bad things. Now, you know the old saying, power tends to corrupt, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. And nothing says absolute power like artificial intelligence. So the idea that we will have an AI instance with more intelligence than humans, artificial general intelligence, is certainly a threat as much as it is an opportunity. And somebody who realized this a while ago was Putin. So here you can say, he says, the nation that leads in AI will be the ruler of the world. This was in September 2017. So we had read that and decided to see what the Russians were up to. And we put together this list here of AI startups in Russia. So there's, what, 10 of them. This was in 2018. And then we went there. I went there and met a number of them. One of them was NTech Lab. You can see this is a picture of their lobby I took. They are a leading facial recognition firm. So when it comes to the sorts of tests that determine who the leaders are, they were competing directly against SenseTime in terms of their capabilities, and they had taken in just 0.05% of SenseTime's $2.6 billion in funding. So what we learned during those conversations were some very interesting things about facial recognition technology. For example, and this was prior to the Rona, they were working on how they could identify a person in less than a second when only 40% of their face was showing. That certainly proved useful when everybody started wearing face masks. They were working on silhouette detection. So after you identify somebody by face, and perhaps they move so that you can't see their face, you can tell who they are by the way they walk, their gait, pretty much any attribute about them. They were utilizing this tech to see if people were throwing punches or breaking windows. Certainly, there were commercial use cases for activity-based tracking, for example, in warehouses and such. But mainly, this was being used for law enforcement across all major Russian cities. They gave us an example of how there was a football match and some hooligans stole the trophy. So they had their facial profiles and they just queried all the cameras in Moscow for the footy games and found these guys very quickly because, of course, they're fans. They're going to go to football games, right? So police were also using this to actively scan faces looking for warrants using eye hardware. They had cameras on every living space in Moscow. The idea being that time is the most important factor in solving crimes. And I don't know how many people knew they were doing this. Certainly, most cities around the world that employ this technology are not going to be exactly forthright about it. And they were exporting it, or let's say they were, probably not anymore, to a firm such as Genetech. And you can see the use cases, airports, retail for shoplifting, energy and utilities, public safety, healthcare, banking, right? But what ended up happening, as you can certainly imagine, is that the founders resigned over disagreements with management and investors about projects in Russia. So they wanted to use facial recognition to identify and detain protesters and opposition activists. And the founder said they wanted NTech Lab to end all work in Russia. And the Russians right now have bigger fish to fry. So as you can imagine, this is the Stanford University Artificial Intelligence Index, and you can see Russia's way down the list. At the top, however, we have the United States, China, and India. Now, in 2018, 2019, we scoured the world for AI startups and concluded that China and the U.S. were neck and neck when it came to AI leadership. And we didn't just write about these companies. I personally visited dozens of them and spoke with their founders. And while some of this research is certainly dated, it still contains lots of interesting insights. So back in 2017, we looked at the top AI startups in China, And for example, the Chinese have been really focused on understanding the world around them, hearing, seeing, and speaking. So you see here what half the startups are either facial recognition or voice recognition. And 80% of Chinese companies, this is from Tsinghua University, they said this in this report about Chinese AI, that 80% of Chinese AI firms are focused on helping AI understand the world, either through computer vision, speech, or natural language processing. One of these was SenseTime, and they're using this platform in at least, this was back then, 16 cities in China with an accuracy rate of close to 99.8%. The system's fast enough to scan China's population in just 1 second, and it takes 2 seconds to scan the world's population. So very efficient, and they were doing things. I think the most impressive use case that I had read about is they have a police car there that can do a 360-degree scan to identify faces at up to 60 yards away while traveling at 75 miles per hour. That's insane, right? So again, we see here them talking about, you know, catching shoplifters and using this for convenience, right? Smile to pay technology at KFC, or facial recognition for check-ins at a hotel or an Airbnb, or to catch cheaters in exams. And also China's the world's biggest facial recognition dealer behind the U.S., so they're exporting this technology as well. It's quite controversial, of course, but when we look at China's ambitions in AI, so back in 2017, they announced their aim of becoming the world's major AI innovation center by 2030, and if their capabilities in electric vehicles say anything about their ability to execute, then this is probably something to be concerned about. So they hope to acquire leapfrog technology, and you see this same statement that Putin made said differently from Xi Jinping. He says, advanced technology is the sharp weapon of the modern state. Now, this report by the European Parliament says this, due to lack of transparency, especially but not only in the defense sector, overall figures on public expenditure on AI in China are subject to considerable caveats and estimates. It's like the 800-pound pumpkin in Mao's Great Leap Forward. You just don't know what to believe. And that's why we took this report from Tsinghua. We wrote about this in 2019 that looked at the state of AI in China. We took it with a grain of salt, but found it to be fairly compelling in that it appeared to be quite objective, right? So pointing out where they had shortcomings. And as of June of 2018, they had counted 4,925 AI enterprises worldwide. So whilst to a lot of people, it seems like AI is just coming on the scene, it's been around for a long time. The country with the most number of citations was China. The top research institutions were in France. China has lots of AI talent. It's not all in the top. That's the U.S. And then Chinese had written 1,000 AI policy documents then, compared to the U.S. at 9 in second place, and other countries lagging behind that. And they also had the most industrial robots. So what we can conclude here is that certain countries in the world can monitor the movements of every person within. So China can control nearly a fifth of the world's population. They're also exporting this technology as well, and you can expect that sensitive spaces will inevitably utilize such technology. When it becomes controversial, they just move it further down the stack. Generative AI can now be used to expand on what we might deem suspicious behavior. So, who leads in AI? Well, according to Stanford, there's three names to watch: China, India, United States. What do they have in common? Well, they have large academic ecosystems, but the talent coming out of those ecosystems is going to differ by country. And if you've worked across these three geographies, as I have, then you've seen that firsthand. In terms of government support, there's a question here, right? Whether their attempt to regulate things supports or hinders, and of course, the capital to fund the right ventures, you need that to be free of nepotism and corruption. So, how do we keep AI from being abused? Well, this was a while ago. This would have been, a year and a half ago. Musk called for a pause on AI, but instead development sped up. And the question here, if we pause AI development in America, are others going to do that? And then when we're using AI to describe reality that exists today, We see a lot of people that want it to describe what they think reality ought to look like. The other problem, this is where they talk about, you know, AI regulation, right? You can't explain the black box, only the data it was fed. And what you have are hallucinations that cause problems, and they may need explanations. Now, the recent disaster over at Google shows how people who want to impose their ideologies on AI are going to create problems. We covered that, anticipated that problem well before it happened in our video here, Google's AI problem. So when it comes to AI regulation, what could countries with no regulations accomplish, right? And how are regulations going to impact investors? Will China or India, are they going to adhere to any sort of global moratorium that's imposed? And will countries do what they say? So this piece by MIT Technology Review talks about what's next for AI regulation in 2024. Talk about how in the USA, Biden signed an executive order on AI at the end of October of last year, wants to establish the new U.S. AI Safety Institute, calling for more transparency and new standards. Then you have the EU. They just agreed on the AI Act, so it's the world's first sweeping AI law. In the most optimistic scenario, it bans certain AI uses. Something to pay attention to there, because if they're banning those, other countries aren't. China, as I said, deeply fragmented and piecemeal. Rather than regulate AI as a whole, they simply release individual pieces of legislation as a new AI product becomes prominent. Then you have India. I was reading that they issued an advisory, the Indian government, requiring Gen AI tech platform companies to obtain explicit approval before publicly releasing any generative AI models or tools. Wow. So you can imagine the bureaucracy happening there. And of course, a big elephant in the room is artificial general intelligence. So Musk recently said that he thinks AI models will surpass human intelligence by the end of next year. So it's already here. Is getting to AGI the true arms race? It would seem like it. Now, this is why the U.S. is not allowing certain semiconductor equipment to be exported to China. And the Chinese have been planning for this, of course, all along. And once you have AGI, provided you can control it, you now have a weapon with capabilities that, by its own nature, we can't even imagine. So the doomsday people have every reason to sound the alarm, but it also makes us wonder, is this another Y2K? When it comes to investing, of course, one big beneficiary here is the company that builds the picks and shovels, NVIDIA. China's rush to homegrown AI chips is apparent as NVIDIA, their cutoff expands. This was in a recent piece by Nikki. U.S. is looking to de-risk the Taiwan situation. You look at Taiwan semiconductor investments and such. We're going to do a piece on that, actually, a video. That's probably coming up next. Make sure you subscribe and then turn on notifications so you see that video. You have platforms like Palantir, they're choosing sides now, playing politics. You have Starlink controlling the skies. The U.S. appears ahead right now intuitively based on generative AI platforms. Their ability to innovate talent is starting to become questionable based on the erosion of universities to what are said to be the world's top universities. But investment dollars are certainly there. What we need to do as investors is consider unknown unknowns. So how do we hedge against those? Well, you need to think about black swan risks, what they call tail risk or value at risk, the 5% probability of something horrible happening. Diversification is going to be your best defense here. Company-specific risk, that's why you don't concentrate your bets. We see a lot of people passing around the same tickers on Twitter talking about how their portfolios are all concentrated, the same names as everybody else. You don't want to do that. You want to make sure you're diversified. Take a holistic look at your assets under management. And what we used to build at MSCI, a tool called Borrow One. It was really cool. I used to play around with it, and you could stress test your portfolio against any one of like 30 different events that occurred in the past and see how it would react. It's a factor-based modeling, super cool stuff. So we're actually going to do a piece related to that coming up that you'll want to watch. Make sure you subscribe for that. So humankind has always risen to the challenge. And I'll just say this, that relating to geopolitics and some of these systems in these countries, that communism has never panned out. Capitalism is the best way forward, and it needs to stay that way. Otherwise, what's the point of investing, right? So When we think about the best AI algos, those are going to quickly be used to train themselves to get better. So a great example would be NVIDIA's chips. Then you have the software side. So that's going to be optimized using intelligent coding agents like GitLab and GitHub. They have lots of great training data to work with. Data is going to determine which AI algorithm comes out ahead. So you ask the question, which country has the most comprehensive, clean, accessible data sets? Well, one example of a country that doesn't is Indonesia. And I spent several months there talking to AI startups. They're still in the chatbot phase, but I talked to a big data startup there, and they have cases where somebody has, in the U.S., we have an identifier known as a Social Security. They have people there with five people sharing the same Social Security number. So they have some real hardcore data problems that need to be cleaned before their algos would work properly. So takeaways, for some, this AI arms race, it's not going to end well at all. And you can see some countries going from fighting crime to being authoritarian. But you're not going to stay objective by picking sides. So always make sure that you approach this stuff as much as possible with an anthropologist mindset. Now, AGI is a powerful weapon for he who masters it, and provided it doesn't turn on its owner. The Chinese have been enabling AI to understand the world, hearing, seeing, and speaking. But the U.S. may have stepped ahead in generative AI. So AI is an arms race, make no mistake. And what I'll do next is leave you with this video on AI hype. Certainly, everybody wants to invest in AI, but you need to be cautious of the landmine. So thanks so much for taking the time to watch this. Please make sure to subscribe to our channel. Thank you.